wave, drum. Touch man can make the place, drum. When you hear the bass, drum. Man them, drum. Gel them, drum. When I'm inside, drum. N-O-V, I bring vibe, drum. Tell a man take time, drum. Man them, drum. N-O-V said drum. N-O-V said drum.
To the Canadian Women's National Team panel at the Allstate Show. We are so excited to have you guys here. And of course, it feels like I am in the presence of royalty. We are speaking with our Olympic medalist, our incredible, legendary women's team. Our panelists are Christine Sinclair, Leanne Wilkinson, Kim LeBron, and Melissa King-Shetty. And we also have a special guest with us here, Sarah. So we're going to be talking, of course, to the ladies, and there's going to be a question and answer period in about 30 minutes. So make sure you guys exit the full screen mode and start sending in your questions in the bottom right corner of your screen. So that way, maybe one of our women's team members will be able to answer your questions. We are going to start off the panel with Christine Sinclair. Now, Christine, one of the biggest moments in Canadian soccer history was, of course, goal number 185. What was that moment like, and what does that mean for your career?
Wow, that seems like a while ago. Lots happened since then. Obviously, it was a weight off my back. When the ball went in the back of the net, it was like relief, I'm not gonna lie, because it's something that had been building and building for, you know, a few years, and it was just like, all right, is this going to happen? Let's come on. And obviously for it to happen in an Olympic qualifying tournament, to get it out of the way in the first game was nice so we could focus on other things. But yeah, I'm not going to lie, it's something pretty cool to have. And I think when I'm done playing, that's something I'll look back and be like, that was a special moment. Not many people can say they've done that. So.
Absolutely. And the next question is for Karina. Now, you've spoken candidly about your personal life, your professional achievements, your development as a player. So, I mean, first off, let's introduce Paris before we get to the question. What a cutie. Welcome. How has that experience been like, that new moment in your life?
Being a mother?
Yeah.
it's one of the most incredible things, I think. You know, sports prepares you for so much, but I think playing for our country probably prepared me to have her and everything that we've been through. So, yeah, I mean, I think you learn so much in being an athlete and playing with these amazing women as you've just seen and will hear today. But this is a true gift, and I can't – look, I'm already giving her the soccer ball so she can be a goalie.
What advice would you have for her when she grows up and for all the young players back home on how to take that step and really become a great soccer player, professional soccer player?
I'd say just make sure that you're always having fun. Like, that's first and foremost. I think each and every one of us will always say we had fun when we were playing. We had fun. You saw it like when we were getting ready for this call. I mean, have fun, dream crazy big. You know, I mean, each and every one of us had crazy dreams, and people laughed at our dreams and thought probably we couldn't do it. And just never don't listen to people who tell you can't do it. Believe in yourself, and then surround yourself with the right people, like these incredible women on the call. Yeah, that would be a teller, but she's got to have fun.
Absolutely. And obviously right now it's such a big moment for Canadian soccer. And Rianne, I want to ask you, you have been described as the exemplary Canadian. What does it feel like for you to put on that red shirt, to put on that jersey and represent your country?
Yeah, that's a big statement. First, I think we should all comment on Melissa's frozen screen, because that is so her.
I know. I'm like,
sorry, everyone.
On my end, that she was.
Oh, I love it. I wish she was holding that pose for that long.
Hopefully, we can get her back.
Oh, don't worry about it. It's great. I like it. Yeah, that's a big thing to say, an exemplary. I'm not sure what that means, but what I think that I've done a good job of is being very clear on who I am and being as consistent with that as possible. And I think that's helped me as a player get where I got to on the senior national team, but also now as a coach. I think consistency of character is critical, especially for players. You know, that doesn't mean you're always nice. It just means that you're consistently who you are, and there's no room for yo-yoing. And it's the same thing as a player. Everything you try and do is to be consistent. And I think that's probably why I've got that interesting tagline.
Amazing. Now, I think Melissa is stepping up for a second. We're going to wait for her to come back, and hopefully we can continue with her part of the panel. But Christine, I think we'll... Oh, she's back. Perfect. Melissa, can you hear us?
Too bad. I was going to answer your question for you, Hank.
So savvy.
No, Melissa, what are some of your fondest memories playing for Canada, but not necessarily things people have seen on TV? So, you know, those moments that we don't really get to experience as fans.
I think everyone just got nervous. Honestly, it's just the camp time. You know, this team was lucky enough to have a lot of centralized programming together and a lot of long camps away. I think the one that really sticks out to me was Cancun. I believe it was, I don't even know, 2015, getting ready for 2015. And we were just cooking, and it was just like a fitness camp. And you saw kind of like the worst of the worst happen to a lot of players, but just the growth that happens in those types of camps. I think those are the memories that will definitely stick in my head forever.
Perfect. And we have a question coming up for Christine. Looking back at Canada's historic back-to-back bronze medals in 2012 and 2016, how similar or how different were those experiences?
Actually quite different. I think heading into London in 2012, pretty much no one except for the players and on the team and the staff expected us to perform the way we did. That was definitely a team that you would go to war with. Every single player had each other's backs. We would fight through anything. You just knew that team was like the heart and soul of that team. Something special was going to happen. And then it's amazing to see the change that can happen in 4 short years. To go to Rio with one of the most talented national teams I've ever been a part of, to walk away with a bronze medal and be disappointed, is something that I don't think many of us as Canadian national team players would think we'd ever say. But we were playing so well that tournament. I'll never forget, I sit in the locker room next to Desiree Scott, and it was after we won bronze. And she looked at her medal, and she's like, I am so disappointed in this. But yeah, 2 completely different experiences. Obviously now they're both very special. Yeah. 2 very similar teams, but completely different.
And looking forward to 2021, I mean, what expectations are there with what can happen now that we've seen these 2 bronze medals, and obviously everyone has gotten so much excitement and so much hype? What can we expect?
Hopefully there will be an Olympics. Hoping for that. Yeah. No, I just think this team, like, anything is possible with this team. The last World Cup, the way we exited was disappointing, but I think you saw performances there. So capable of beating anyone. We're just continuing to grow, and it's just a matter of together in the biggest tournaments. And I have no doubt this team's capable of winning gold, but we actually have to go do it.
Of course, and the whole country is behind you, ladies, as always. I saw this tweet the other day that asked, do men have women icons? And I think that the 4 ladies that are sitting here are definitely icons for every boy and every girl that is growing up playing soccer. And Karina, specifically you as a goalkeeper, I think you've played such an important role in Canada soccer. So what are some of the ways that you see the game that helps your team? I mean, you're obviously helping them get aligned and get ready. So what do you think you added to that team in 2012 and 2016 as well?
Um, I hope mine's working because it seems a bit stuck right now. But I think you asked, what does goalkeepers add to the team, or what I added to the team? Is that right?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Well, everyone's going to say goalkeepers are crazy. So that's what we add to the team. We add, but see, there, everyone's nodding their head. But I tend to say that goalkeepers are geniuses, to be honest with you. cue the laughter. No, I think it's a unique position because, first of all, you have the best visual of the field. You get to lead in a way where you're not maybe as involved at minute by minute, but in terms of leadership, you're able to add that way. But I think for me, I was just, I don't know, I guess one of the things as a goalkeeper, you want to add some confidence to the team to know that, you know, if anything, we've got your back. You know, we're here. And for our perspective, if we do something bad, we'll put our hand up and say, you know, I've got this. I mean, I know I've let in some bad goals throughout my career, but I think one of the things is when you turn and you see your players and they believe in you, that's one of the things that helps you. But as a goalkeeper, I think everyone makes fun, but someone's got to get in there. It's just, you just have to be brave and just know that no one moment defines you for letting a ball in, but that you have the support of the team. So everyone calls us crazy. I think we're normal. I think my husband doesn't want her to be a goalkeeper, but I want her to be a goalkeeper because I think it's a genius move. But yeah, we love all the heck we get, but I think it's the best position in the world, and I just love it.
And I think there could be a lot of kids back home that play goalie, and maybe because of this whole lockdown period, they still haven't been able to get back on the pitch with their teammates. So how would you suggest they practice without having any teammates or anyone around to really practice their position?
You know, it's interesting because even when we used to train, the goalkeepers would get there before the field players, and then we train with the field players. So there's lots you can do as a goalkeeper. One of the things is now that football is back or soccer is back is just watch goalkeepers, watch and study them, learn from them. But, you know, you could go kicking balls against like walls and just reacting or just doing fast footwork stuff. I think it's a position where you could do a lot on your own when, you know, in your backyard, you don't necessarily need to have people shooting on you, just techniques, putting the ball in. There's tons online. So I think, but the biggest thing is just to stay encouraged. Don't get discouraged because, I mean, no one can play, but there's an opportunity now just to study the game and do some drills on your own.
Of course. Now, the next question is for Rianne. I mean, the Canadian women's national team is seeing some incredible talent right now. I mean, we've got girls like Ashley Lawrence, Jordan, and of course, so many other incredibly talented ladies. I want to know, how important are they right now? And as a veteran, what advice or what are you helping them for the next few years? How are you helping them out?
Well, first, I like that you're calling me a veteran because it makes me feel like I'm still a player. So thanks. There's a lot of amazing talent coming through. I think the best example I can give you is our 2016 team. We got it wrong in 2015. And by that, I mean we had a lot of great talent. Ashley and all those players were there. But I don't think we were able to make them feel as much a part of the team as they should have. And I really believe we learned from that. And in 2016, whether you'd been on the team for 6 months or you'd been on the team for, you know, 45 years, like Sink, you had the right to be there. You'd earned that opportunity. And I think that's a hard thing to do, especially for players that have had to go through so much to be in that position. But Deanne Rose, who'd been on the team for 6 months, earned that bronze medal as much as any of us who were veterans. And in fact, she went on, and Jessie, I believe, assisted Sinky's goal in the bronze medal game against Brazil, Deanne scoring a goal. Like, you need your youth to feel like they are, it's their team. It's so critical. And then you look at the talent we have now, and I believe our veteran players at this time have really, really done a good job making them feel like this is their team. They can't wait for our veterans to retire before they step up to the plate and own the team. So it's critical, and it's a blow to your ego for a while for the older players. But if you want to be a winning team, you've got to figure that out.
And when it comes to a lot of the kids that are back home, and maybe they're watching this and they want to become a national team player in 5-10 years, what's the best path? What do you recommend the parents to do, the kids to do, to really form themselves as players?
it's a big question. I think you've got to love what you do, and that's the number one. So we're not getting into debates about single sport, multiple sport, about how much extra coaching you need to pay for. I think it starts with a real interest from the kid, not the parent, because interest turns into passion. So I would say for myself, I was equally as interested in hockey. I played ringette. I used to love going out and playing baseball with my brother and sister and friends. Soccer was a part of what I did as well as rugby. And then slowly I got more and more interested in soccer over the other ones, and it became a passion. It didn't happen overnight. And when that develops, you do extra training by accident. Like going to the park with your friends doesn't feel like extra training because you're just having fun. And I would argue that the top athletes all over the world, not just in soccer, have stories that are very similar. The extra time they did, like outside kicking the ball against the wall, Gretzky on his backyard pond, but it wasn't about that. It was because they loved doing it. And that doesn't come because you tell someone to love something. They've got to find that themselves.
And I love that you mentioned that the kid has to love it, because sometimes you do see the stories where it's the parents forcing the kids. And it's so important that you have the love of the sport. And that's, I'm sure, what has made all of you so successful. Melissa, I want to ask you about the support of the fans. I mean, it's obviously incredible to see how Canadian fans have gotten behind the women's national team. But can you share what the difference is when you're at home wearing the Canadian jersey versus when you were abroad?
Yeah, I think in the beginning of our careers, I think we got used to always playing abroad or with someone else's crowd. So, you know, that pressure wasn't really there. And I think what really changed that feeling, I would say, was 2015. That opening game in the World Cup, like that's the epitome right there of playing in front of a home crowd and opening up the World Cup in your home country. I think that type of feeling you can't even describe. It's something that you think about and dream about as a little kid. And you know, those crowd noises you make in your head just times 1 million is what exactly it feels like. I think in terms of the support, I mean, London 2012 did everything for us. I think even having the support in between the semifinals and the finals, and having, you know, everyone tweeting and the social media aspect of it and pushing us into that finals or that bronze medal game, really, we had no legs on us, but it was just the passion of everyone behind us and doing it for a country that is fully on board back home, watching every second of our games. So I think it's changed soccer for us. As individuals, as a team, but massively for this country. I think just the buy-in of our country that happened in that 2012, it started with, you know, Sinky and her crew back in Commonwealth, but to grow the game now where you're getting like 30,000, maybe 50,000 for a game is incredible, especially for the female game.
Of course. And I feel like that fan excitement and that passion really pushes forward in a game, especially when maybe things aren't going your way. Do you think for current players right now, without having anyone in the stands, is that going to affect the mindset? Is that going to be harder to feel that home field advantage?
I mean, I'm going to say I've played in some empty stadiums, so absolutely. I feel like it takes a lot more willpower and mental preparation to really get to that level that you need to get to before that whistle goes. And there's a difference between going out into a stadium that's empty to going out to a stadium that's fully packed with a crowd behind you cheering, you know. And obviously, you know, the play it has and the involvement of the referee as well, it really makes the game. But I, you know, watching the games now, it's quite awkward for me as a spectator. Now they have the crowd noises and things like that. But it was a bit awkward in the beginning because you do hear what it's like to be in an empty stadium, a lot of chatter. And I can't imagine getting up and getting involved in Champions League finals with nobody in the stands. It must take so much preparation behind the scenes.
Absolutely. Now, before we continue with the panel, just a reminder to everyone back home, the question and answer period will start in 10 minutes. So make sure you keep sending out all of your questions. If you're in full screen, you have to exit the full screen and you'll find the chat box in the bottom right corner. Now we'll continue with Christine. Now you've had a chance to see the development of women's soccer and be a part of so many historic moments for women's soccer in Canada. Where do you see the future of the sport going? Specifically though, to the women's team.
Yeah, I think over the past, 4-5 years, we've just seen an explosion in women's football around the world. And I think in Canada, the next step would be a professional environment. I think we're one of the only, if not the only, top-ranked national team that doesn't have a professional environment for the women's players. And that's like my next passion. That's my next goal, is to help facilitate that. Because I honestly believe the future of the women's program and women's football in Canada depends on it. Because players need a place to play after club, after college, after their youth soccer careers are over. And as a youngster, if you see it happening, you truly believe it can happen to you. And so I think these young Canadians need to be able to witness professional women soccer players in their home country and, aspire to be them. So that's the next goal.
And as of today, what path would you recommend those young women that are back home that want to take a pro career? How can they take that next step in their journey?
Well, I think it's like Rian said, it starts with the passion and the hard work and dedication. I mean, there's no secret to success. It is living what you do and putting in the time and effort into it. I think the debate is starting now. For the longest time, especially here in North America, it's college, university down in the States. And I think you're starting to see that evolve and change. Personally, I'd still recommend it for most, but you're seeing the professional game develop so much. We have Canadian players that have decided to skip university and go straight to the professional game in Europe or here in the U.S. You're starting to see that. More opportunities are becoming available. More leagues are growing. It's an exciting time for female soccer players, that's for sure.
Absolutely. Now, we have another question for Karina and Paris, who I think was trying to get a few words in there herself. Now, Karina, you are head of CONCACAF Women's Soccer. What are some objectives or key things that you want to implement for women's soccer in these next few years?
I got into this position because I think something that you're seeing more so of women is that we played on the 2012 team where we represented our country for so many years together, but it was instilled in us that we had, and just like what Sink is talking about, like we felt that we had the obligation to continue to give back to the game. Rees in coaching now, Tank's doctor of chiropractor, Sink, she's going to go on and take on the world when she decides to step away. But it was like all of us seeing where can we continue to give back to the game that has given so much to us. And I think for me now at CONCACAF, it's like connected my purpose and my passion, right? So my passion was with this country and helping and grow it. And now I get to do it across 41 countries. So it's just telling the stories of the power of the game, what it's done for us, what it will allow us to do in life. I think we're just trying to, in some of our countries, young girls shouldn't even be playing a sport, So you have the reality of a country in Canada where we're seen as heroes to so many, but then some countries, they don't even think young girls should be playing sports. So it ranges. But I think one of the things is just to keep telling these amazing stories of the next Christine Sinclairs, the next Melissa Tancredis, the next Rhea Wilkinsons, and take this woman's game to a different level. Because I'm passionate about it. I want to do it for her, just like all of us on this call. It's for, like Sink says, you have to see to believe it. So it's creating pathways for players. Once they're done playing, how can I still stay in the sport? How can I give back to the sport? And how can I continue to make it better?
And Rian, to build off of that, you're taking on a coaching position. What message do you usually give your players? How do you inspire them to keep building the sport forward?
I really believe that's what makes Canada unique. We don't have a league right now. We have players playing all over the world. Winning Champions Leagues today, Kadisha Buchanan, we have Alphonso Davies on the men's side. Part of what we do is maximize the time we have together as much as possible. And that is about growing the game, having a bigger purpose than just the game itself. And we started talking about that in 2011 into 2012, the legacy piece. And it wasn't just, you hear that word a lot, it's a buzzword. But for us, it took on a whole new meaning. And from that team, I was just doing a presentation, but I think only three of the players have not continued in sport in some way. And I say that only because I'm not sure they might have, which is incredible. It meant something for us. And I think even though there's more publicity in the game, obviously more success in the game, more sponsorship in the game, for Canadians, it comes back to that grassroots part, the connection with the fans, the connection to the people here, and keeping that. I think it's essential for our success and to who we are as people and as players and as athletes.
Absolutely. And Melissa, talk to us about your contributions as well to soccer. I mean, you are a doctor of chiropractor. It is such an incredible way to help the athletes. So what is your purpose and what is your end goal with helping out the sport?
I think just I'm in a totally different seat, obviously, on the medical side of things. But, you know, I've seen success in my personal practice just because of what I've been through as an athlete. And to be able to speak that language of people coming in with injuries, and I've had a lot, and, you know, how to get through them and now how to treat them and kind of guide them into a healthier lifestyle. I think for me, it's still staying involved with the team in what I'm good at. And I'm not a coach by any means, but in what I can add on away from the field and a little bit on the field as well, but continuing to kind of give that guidance that I did as a player as well, and continue the stories and kind of continue the culture of this team. I think the more you have the right personnel around the team, and hopefully it continues, this is a cycle that will continue. We want this to be the next 5, 10, 15 years of this women's team, and hopefully into the men's team as well. Now with some of our staff, our players, former players going into the men's team, this is something that, you know, thankfully John saw this as well. It's been a dream of all of ours to stay with the sport and continue to change the sport in our country. And I think the more you can do so, not only in my little environment here in Vancouver, I'm part of BC Soccer as well, but to kind of get your hands into the national team and help the players develop so that we're continually and consistently creating great product. And I think it helps when you have fantastic leaders, you know, leading around the world with Karina, Rian coaching around the world, and Sinky's just, who knows what she can do, but she's going to kill it no matter what she does. I feel like she should be hired by every company, but it's just, this is what you want for our game. And I think it's so exciting in the future thinking about it.
Of course. And Melissa, I mean, you were known as such a strong player on the field. You went by the nickname Tank, not just because of your name. Why? Describe the meaning of tank.
I actually want to say because it's because of my name. I'm not the biggest player. I'm only 5'8¼". I won't say my weight because it's post playing, but I think, you know, I'm a passionate person and player. And I think these women will tell you, I will do anything for them, and I will do anything for a teammate. And whether it be competition or whatever drove me, I would, doesn't matter what I'm breaking on my body. Like, I will do anything to either score a goal or to help someone score a goal or to win or to stick up for somebody. You know, that's kind of how I saw our team. Our team was a family, and that's my role in my family as well. I don't break things for my family, but that's kind of what my role was. And I think Tank, spelt with a C, is because of my name, but I think just my playing style was a bit, people say aggressive, I would say passionate, but I would do anything for my teammates. I really would. And I think that's what drove me. And I think that's what probably made me successful. I wasn't the most skillful player out there, but I would give you everything in every game, everything I could physically. So I think that's kind of what stuck. And I think the nickname stuck as well. And I just filled out maybe when I was 16, 17. So all those football workouts.
I love that. All right, now it's time to go to the fan Q&A. So I'm just going to have a quick look and start calling out some questions that the fans want to know. Okay, we're going to start off with Emily. She has a question for Rian. Do you have any advice for how to continue to develop yourself as a coach?
Well, I think it's important to say that I never thought I was going to be a coach. And I say that with all due respect. There's not always a path. You change your mind, things come up, and that's what happened for me. And I had opportunities to take my coaching badges. I was injured, and I'm really glad I did that. And it sparked an interest in me. And then I got an opportunity to help support one of our youth teams. Kadisha was on that team. Ashley was on that team. Jesse Fleming, Kaylin Sheridan, Shalina Zdorsky. I mean, an incredible team. They're our under 20s. And it started to go like that. So I would say say yes to as many opportunities as possible. Make yourself step out on the field. You're going to be uncomfortable, but there's no better way to learn than just getting out there. And you're going to make mistakes, just like as a player. It's never going to be perfect. But yeah, I think it's just saying yes to opportunities and getting your coaching badges. You've got to do that.
Melissa, we have a question from John. How has your role with BC Soccer as a director enhanced your continued contributions to the game here in our province?
Is this John on the BC board? Planted question. It's. I feel like my vision is very player-centric. Obviously, I was a player my whole career, so I think I'm vision clear in helping the player develop and helping grow the game in the most honest, productive, and equal way possible. I think it's nice to have another woman on the board. It's nice to have a younger woman on the board who just finished playing and who's kind of seen the sport in a different light on the international stage. I think any diversity you can add to a board, absolutely, I'm always for, and especially different backgrounds, different stories. Like, you want that. You can't have the same type of person on a board and try to create or develop the game. So I think my role is kind of added a little more player-centric and a little more diversity in terms of the women's game and trying to push that as well.
Now, Christine, we have a question from Connor. He says, as a striker, how can I work on my finishing?
Just kick it where the goalkeeper isn't, right, Karina? No, honestly, for me, it's just all about reps. Getting in front of goal, trying to be as comfortable as possible in front of goal. Just ball striking as much as possible. And then I think as a striker, it's about risk taking, you know, being okay to mess up, being okay to lose the ball from time to time, knowing that, yeah, it just takes one moment of brilliance to put the ball in the back of the net, and everyone forgets about the 95 times you lost the ball earlier in the game. So, no. For me, it's all about reps, day in, day out. Yeah, being comfortable as possible in front of goal.
Perfect. I was a forward with Sink at the start of my career. Terrible. But I asked her that. I was like, how do you always score? It's amazing. And she's like, I put it where the goalkeeper isn't, and then walked off. I was like, this is the worst thing I've ever. It was so harsh. But like, that wasn't a joke advice. She means it. I think a technique, but it literally is about understanding your own technique and putting it where the goalkeeper isn't. It's that basic. I never got it.
And I'll add to that with two. Listen, I was, when Sink first came into the national team camp, that was the first thing I noticed about her. I remember she had a ball within the 6 yards and most people would try to hammer it home and she just placed it. So it sounds silly, but she literally lives by that. Put the ball where the goalkeeper isn't. So, yeah.
How does that make you feel, Karina? I mean, having to hear that, was it difficult going up against like Christine in practice or taking shots from her?
She never scored on me, so I don't even know. No, I'm just kidding. No, you know, I think one of the things is that I think we all feel honored to have played with Sink, because we played with and against the greatest, female player in the world. I mean, she's proven it over and over with her ability to finish, but the leader that she is. And I think for us, it was an honor to step on the field. You know, there were games where she carried us, and then there was games where we performed as a team. But I think the biggest thing, and that's what you see about our team, is that it was just, as Tank said, like, it's where we were best friends. And that was the best part about winning the medal. It wasn't like the fact that we'd won. It was the journey that we'd been through. Like, those tears were because, like, you're standing next to your best friend who you know would go through a wall for you, who would sacrifice family and some of the biggest moments in their life for you. Here we are standing on the podium, and the history and everything that went for it was important. But we looked at each other and we knew that we were broken 9 months before. And look at us, we rose, and we rose together. And this is, you know, like, you saw us in the call where we started. It was like we just seen each other yesterday, you know? And that's what's just really special about these women. And, you know, for me, I've been through some tough times in the last bit with, you know, having my on this call right now. Like, we show up for each other. That's what we've been managed. That's okay. Did I get disconnected?
Yeah, but I bet it was powerful.
All I was saying is that it's the best part about playing for this country is obviously wearing that flag in the heart, but it's the friendships. It's I know that in my worst moment, when I was going through my worst time, these women showed up for me, and that's what we have for each other. So it goes so far beyond kicking a ball for a country. It's what it means to us to stand on that field and represent this country. So I'll be quiet there.
No, that was amazing. And actually, this next question kind of ties into that as well. Tom wants to know, and I'll leave this open to whichever one of you wants to answer, what has been the biggest difference between the World Cup experience and the Olympic experience?
Melissa?
You were. Wow. I just feel like the World Cups have been so disappointing, right? And I think the biggest difference, I don't know what the biggest difference was, but because they happened at so many different transitional times in our careers. Like, I would say 2011, you know, tactically, we weren't there yet. The preparation, we weren't there yet. But 2012, I feel like the preparation was, like, drilled into us. And we kind of had our identity, like, just nailed down by John. 2015-16, I mean, call it a pressure moment, call it a transition time with the team again, with a lot of youngsters coming in. But then Rio was, like, really meshing those young, exactly what Rian said, giving them a voice. I literally think that we think the World Cup is maybe like a trial period, and then we like fine tune it for the Olympics. Like, I don't even know, that's not how it's supposed to happen, but I feel like we just end up showing up in the Olympics. I think it's just odd timing. Every single World Cup to Olympics, well, the past two, I would say, have been massive transition periods for this team. And maybe it's just one coach or figuring out what we need to kind of nail down and doing it in 9 to 10 months. But I think Rio was, I think, a time where we actually used our weapons properly, and we used a full bench, and we used our youth players, and we used our massive tactics that we've been working on for years and years and years, and we actually had them down with the right players in the right positions. I think 11 to 12, you're looking at definitely that was grinding it out. Like, we wanted that 2011. We thought we were prepared. We were a great team, but we just didn't have the tactical ability, and we had to take steps towards that to expand and challenge ourselves tactically. And then you just nail down the fact that these girls have been trying to do something for so long, been living together for so long, and it was like a do or die moment for us. That was it, because we knew a lot of girls would be leaving after that period. So, I mean, there's no real one answer if anyone wants to answer.
All right. I think no one else wants to answer that question.
Well, I'll just say, I mean, on a lighter note, like, the Olympics is pretty cool because you're surrounded by other athletes who are at the peak performance, right? And you get to meet some of these people who, you know, whether it was LeBron James or, I mean, Kobe Bryant, like, or, you know, female like the Serena Williams, you get to meet amazing athletes and have conversations with them. And I think, take away the football, that's what's super cool about the Olympics as well. You know, I'm just throwing in something non-soccer. Go ahead.
Did you guys ever fangirl over someone? Like, I mean, obviously Kobe Bryant, LeBron James, but were you starstruck at any moment during the Olympics?
Take it away, Karina.
No, I'll have a conversation with anybody, right? So that's the truth. I mean, I sat down and had lunch with Serena Williams and a sister. I think you guys thought that was all crazy, but I'm like, hey, I see you guys every day. I'm just going to sit down. And it's super cool. But again, I'm a little crazier than everyone else. So, yeah.
Karina, I mean, Karina, we should tell the story about Shawn Johnson, the gymnast.
Yeah.
She was like, she had like, that was, it was London, and she was having a stellar moment. I think she just won gold. And Karina and I had just finished dinner. We're like, that's Shawn Johnson. Let's go, let's go, let's go. Ask for an autograph. So we went up, we walked next to her. And then we were like, I think Karina asked because I clammed up. And Karina was like, hey, huge fans here. Can we get an autograph? And she was like, no, I'm kind of in a hurry. And then we continued to walk next to each other for the next 10 minutes. Do you remember that? We were like so awkward. So we just kept her. We were like trying to walk faster. We're like, this is so awkward. Just got denied hard. But it's just like, I was like Usain Bolt. I think we lost a teammate with Jodian Robinson. She was trying to find Usain Bolt for like a week and a half. Messi, Neymar, crazy moments.
I actually think that this tied into the best advice we were given, and it didn't work. But before we went to our first Olympics in Beijing, I believe someone said, don't become tourists. And until you've experienced an Olympics, you don't understand what that means. But you get there and, you know, we were sharing, I think Messi was in the building next to ours. We watched Usain Bolt win his first gold. Like we had incredible experiences, and that was pretty special, but we actually had to learn from that it's a tournament. We're in a tournament and it's business. And it's really easy to get caught up in the festival that is the Olympics. And I think after that, 2012 and 2016, we were able, because we'd experienced it before, to help our young ones through it and give them that experience, because they do need to enjoy that it is special. Becoming an Olympian on its own is an incredible achievement, but you're actually there for work. It's a tournament for you. It's the Olympics for the spectators. And we actually, we didn't get that right in 2008.
I can say this.
Amazing pictures.
Yeah, I was going to say that. But I have no idea where those pictures are now. I know where my medal is.
If you know where your medal is, that would be a little scary. Now, speaking of advice for the younger generations, Chloe wants to know, Christine, what advice would you give your 10-year-old self about making it in soccer?
What advice would I give my 10-year-old self? I probably just like do what you did, man. It turned out okay. No, like, because growing up, I mean, like, I'm pretty sure everyone on this call, I played multiple sports growing up, had a balanced childhood, but sports were the focal point. And like Rena mentioned, soccer just slowly became my passion. And yeah, to this day, I still don't think I've worked a day of actual work in my life because I love what I do so much. And growing up, I always had a soccer ball at my feet. My brother and I were always in the backyard playing. My advice would probably be more to like my 25, 26, 27 year old self, where it's just like, just relax a little bit, like enjoy the moments more. Like, I've definitely been some places with the team where, yeah, I don't remember trees that I've been to because I was like so focused on sports. So just, yeah, probably take a few more moments and enjoy how fortunate I am. And fortunate I've been to be able to like travel this amazing world. Yeah.
Amazing. Now Laurel has another question for you ladies. Now I'm not sure which one of you wants to take the lead on this one, but for young athletes looking to improve their mental game, you are going to make mistakes on the field, but how do you let that go so you can continue playing and you can continue going towards that goal and that final win?
Rena?
Okay, I think you have to understand that like failure is actually awesome, because when you actually are able to be in the midst of it, if whether it's an injury, for example, I know Tank and I at one point, we had a big injury together, and it was one of those things where we sat in the pit together and smiled, because you know that it's temporary, and once you get through it, you're going to find a better version of yourself. And I think it's one of those things, is just understanding that you're learning through every tough time. You're learning about yourself. You're learning about your capacity. You're learning. So don't make it define you. What defines you is the work ethic, the way you find your way out. You surround yourself with like-minded people. Like, I mean, I think anybody on this call right now knows that the people that we were surrounded with on an everyday basis were incredible like-minded women who are connected on something bigger than themselves. So I just say, like, you know what, like, it's going to pass, whether it's an injury or a bad moment. As a goalkeeper, I never let think it's more
super powerful again, though, for sure.
Yeah, I think we're gonna have to wait for Karina to continue. I liked where it was going, but we lost you for a second.
I heard tango for sure. I just said, like, one moment doesn't define you. Like, if you, like, everybody knows Christine Sinclair, for example, for her hundreds of goals, but that's not what defines her as a human being. What defines her is her work ethic, her ability every single day to want to be a better version of herself, her being inspired but more than herself. And just if anything bad happens, just know that you're going to get through it, and that's going to just help you become a better version of yourself.
For sure. Now, this next question is from Brenda for Christine. What was it like playing in a bubble? What was that experience like?
So it actually was fine. I think those of us that have been on national teams and have lived residency camps and been to World Cups and Olympics, we're used to living in a hotel. Like, that's, I'm perfectly fine with having my little room and that's it. I think some of the players that maybe haven't been on national teams struggled a bit more. Just, they're not used to being in a hotel for over a month straight. It was interesting to have zero fans and like have 10 a.m. kickoffs. Like, that was not ideal for me. It was great to be back playing, and we all felt safe. I think heading into the tournament, we were all, you know, should the NWSL be the like going first and seeing if this is okay? Like, you know, maybe we should let the NBA or someone maybe with a little bit more financial backing, like, see how it goes. But it ran very smoothly, real positive tests. And it was nice to be back competing.
And you mentioned without fans. How hard was that to adjust? I mean, how difficult was it to get into the mindset of having to play as if it were a practice game?
I think it was Tank that said this earlier. Unfortunately, as female athletes, there's been moments where, you know, we play in front of 5-10 fans. So we're used to it in the sense, but to have absolutely no one there, especially like coming from Portland where we average like 20,000 fans at our home games, it's kind of a letdown because the crowd gives you so much energy and it's a unique environment. But surprisingly, once the game kicked off, once the ref blew the whistle, it's the exact same, you know. I think we all do a very good job of cleaning out the fans anyway. So once the whistle blew, it was like,
now, there's another question here that I actually am very curious to know the answer to. Again, I'll let you guys decide who will take this one, but what is a funny memory you have about each other when you played on the national team?
I think it might be my turn. I have a hilarious memory, but before I do that, Sink, can you say happy birthday to Chloe and her twin?
Happy birthday, Chloe and twin.
I just saw her wrote that and I was like, oh, I hope we are able to get to it. So I'm just making sure. We were living in Rome and occasionally we would drive in and I don't know what we were doing, but I was in a car with Karina and you might have been in it. I think I don't remember you there, but I remember just yelling the whole time, Karina, this is not a road. This is not a road. Anyway, didn't we drive straight into like one of the main piazzas in Rome? And then she just parked the car. She just left it. I was like, this isn't a parking spot. This is definitely not a car area. Anyway, we ended up getting, I can't even remember how many parking tickets got sent to us after we moved back from Rome. But most of my memories in Rome are like driving with Karina there and getting like, we were on pedestrian walkways probably 50% of the time. I 100% think that. And they're still probably looking for you in Rome. I'd be careful going back there.
Listen, the roads are smaller. They're roads, Ree. They're not pedestrian.
No, I have to agree with Karina on that. The roads in Rome, I don't think they're actually really roads. You just drive where you want.
Listen, those red signs with the big white bar across it, those are universal. Just not to Karina.
Listen, I got us to the main, the Trevi Fountain. I got us to where we needed to go.
You're right. We drove right? through the crowd and it was something.
We're gonna keep the stories to ourselves, right? No, I think it's just, I mean, like, let's talk about the locker room, okay?
Let's not.
Tank and I mean, like the band, Ree likes the podcasts, Ree likes, you know, reading like her pump up songs, because we used to have a playlist that everybody got to put in a song, and we always knew when Ree's came in. I don't know, so many of the memories, I don't know. I loved dancing with Tank. I loved sitting down having coffee with Sink. Ree, we just laughed. You made me laugh all the time. You just do things that make me laugh.
I have a good memory of Karina. I'll tell this one, because the rest I feel like I can't tell. But we were doing karaoke at the end of one tournament. I think we were in China, and we had a karaoke room, and I think we were sharing with the U.S. team. I don't know. We opened it up to everyone to come watch. And Karina, you know, she'd always complain about her low back and whatever. Everything's hurting. And Karina was singing Madonna. She took it away. Madonna. And she jumped off of the stage into the splits. Do you remember that, Karina?
Just living in the moment.
Everyone was like, she's never taking a day off ever again. She complains ever again.
Living in the moment. Living in the moment. That's all I gotta say. Living in the moment.
I love
those jewels. Definitely live in the moment.
No.
Sinky's pretty mellow. Like, Sinky has, I mean, like, if you're gonna tell stories about Sinky, you probably can't. That's why. Like, she usually keeps it here, unless it's here and here. And you just keep it, you know. Ree, I mean, I've got stories, but I feel like she's still trying to date, so I don't want to ruin it for her. Ree's pretty chill as well, so.
We pulled some pranks too. Tank's a big prankster. Yeah. Let's talk about that. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, specifics, we could be here all day, but it's not as much fun for other people when we just sit here laughing and we can't get the words out. So
it's true. I'm sure they're loving it. I'm sure they are. Now, ladies, unfortunately, our time is slowly coming to an end. So before we do close this off, I want to give each of you an opportunity to give a message or say something to all of the viewers that are watching you back home and that are living vicariously through you, or that hope to one day achieve what some of you have achieved as well. So let's start off with Karina. What message would you have for everyone back home?
I would just say more to the times that we're in. You know, we all have our stories during COVID, but I just say it's important to just keep perspective that we're going to get through this. And I think that's what I learned through playing and transitioning out of playing and living in life. I just say, you know, sometimes you realize that life is bigger than, you know, the football game. And I think we all know that here, but that just to stay positive and we're going to get through this and just be the best version of yourself every single day in whatever capacity it looks like, just go towards that. And yeah, I'm far removed from the game further than these ladies, so they can tap into however else. But yeah, that's it.
Perfect. Melissa, how about you?
I feel like a lot of the talk has been how to get to the national team, and I think we kind of lose focus of basically just using sport as a development. You know, I think myself as a woman and how independent and confident I am, and the lessons I've learned are all through sport. The friends that I've kept to this day are all through sport. So it's not kind of losing sight of what sport can add to your life and then really embrace it. And like Karina, everyone has said, literally, if you love it, play it, be passionate about it, but just also be present and realize what it's giving you. Like, a lot of corporate places pay a lot of money to teach these lessons that you learn very easily through sport. So just embrace it and really enjoy the journey it takes you, because it could not be the national team, but it could be somewhere else, you know, that we're really making a difference in this world.
Absolutely. And Ree, do you have a message for all the fans back home before we go?
Well, I love what Melissa just said there, and I do think that's critical. The bigger success story is actually the player who starts at 5, 6, 7 and continues playing as an adult. The game or any sport that you play, it's a real issue, I think, on the women's side that almost we say, like, once my real life begins, like after I play soccer, my real life starts. And it's such a mentality. What really frustrates me, I don't think you hear it on from boys or men as much. It's the gifts that the game gives you. They'll stay with you forever. And, you know, I'm retired now, but these women will continue to be my sisters and my biggest support system for the rest of my life. And that's from the game. It's not because we played together for a national team. It's because we went, we played together, you know, Melissa and I, since we were 18. So it's, the reality is sport gives you so much more than the game. So enjoy it. And it really is most of my job at the moment, coaching the youth, is trying to get them to, like, calm down, like, enjoy being here. It's just what Sink talked about, advice to herself in her 20s, enjoy what you're doing at the time. Don't always be so future focused that you miss what you're doing at, like, right now. That's all.
Amazing. And Christine, your message for everyone back home.
I think it's just for the kids, the young kids out there. Just being okay to dream those, like, wild dreams. Each person here, part of this chat, I'm sure had crazy dreams as a kid. And as Karina mentioned earlier, we probably, like, told, oh, that will never happen, or laughed at. But we're, like, living proof that sometimes those wild dreams that you have as a kid come true. Takes a lot of work and sacrifice, but sometimes, you know, they do come true. So dream those crazy wild dreams and go after them.
Absolutely. Thank you, ladies, so much for joining us and for being such an inspiration to boys and girls across Canada. I mean, I think it's incredible that there's so many young girls that now, because of you and your teammates, aren't scared to stay in soccer and they aren't scared to go after those dreams. So thank you really for what you've done for the sport and for giving us your time on this Sunday evening.
No problem.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, everyone back home as well, for joining us on the All State Soccer Show. We hope you enjoy the panel and we wish you all the best. Bye, ladies.
Bye.